He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Welcome to St. Paul Evangelical Lutheran Church. It is fantastic to get to gather with you this Easter Sunday morning to celebrate the greatest moment in history, the confirmation of our faith, the confirmation of hope and peace and a future for us and for humankind. If you're a guest with us today, everything that you'll need is going to be right here in the folder that you have in front of you. At this moment, though, we are going to begin with singing our opening hymn on page 2, I Know That My Redeemer Lives. May God richly bless your worship and your Easter celebrations this morning. We begin, as we always do in God's house, with our God's blessing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. We have a baptism this Easter morning. Our Savior Jesus Christ commanded baptism when he said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." All of us are born into this world with a deep need for baptism. From our parents, we inherit a sinful nature. We are without true fear of God and true faith in God and are condemned to eternal death. But Jesus took away our sin by giving his life on the cross, and he proved that our sins were forgiven by rising 3 days later. At our baptism, he clothes us with the robe of his righteousness and gives us a new life. Our sinful nature need not control us any longer. We recall what baptism means for our daily lives as we speak these words together. Baptism means that the sinful nature in us should be drowned by daily sorrow and repentance, and that all its evil deeds and desires be put to death. It also means that a new person should daily arise to live before God in righteousness and purity forever. At this point, I invite forward baby Ella and the sponsors and parents. And Lee, why don't you stand right here on this side? In obedience to the command of our Lord and trusting in his promise, you brought Ella to be baptized. Jesus told us, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." It is in baptism that God grants the new life of forgiveness, joy, and peace to little children. By the power of God's word, this gracious water of life washes away sin, delivers from death and the devil, and gives eternal salvation to all who believe. So Ella, receive the sign of the cross on the head and on the heart to mark you as a redeemed child of Christ. ahead and bring her head right over. Ella, Zahara, Irene, Sean, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. There you go. Ooh, I think I got a little rise. There you go. The Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, has forgiven all your sins, Ella. By your baptism, you are born again and made a dear child of your Father in heaven. May God strengthen you to live in your baptismal grace all the days of your life. Ella, peace be with you. Everyone, please stand at this time. Brothers and sisters in Christ, our Lord commands that we teach his precious truths to all who are baptized. Christian love, therefore, urges all of us, especially parents and sponsors, to assist in whatever manner possible so that Ella may remain a child of God until her death. If you are willing to carry out this responsibility, then let's answer yes as God gives me strength.
Yes, as God gives me strength.
Let's pray. Merciful Father in heaven, we thank you for the blessing of baptism by which you offer and grant the forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. Help us to regard our own baptisms as the robe of righteousness we are to wear all the days of our life. Look with special favor on Ella and grant her a rich measure of your Spirit that she may grow in faith and godly living. Make us willing to carry our responsibilities to those who have been baptized so that all of us may finally come to the blessed joys of heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're done. You may be seated. Yeah. Let's continue then with our Easter Psalm of Proclamation. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
The Lord is my strength and my song. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. I will not die, but live. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's pray. On this day when we celebrate your glorious resurrection, as the angels shared infectious joy with the women, as the women shared contagious joy with the disciples, as that same joy spreads to us even today, it is a joy that enriches our lives as we serve you, our Savior.
Risen Lord, give us joy.
It is a joy that anticipates heaven's eternal courts of joy.
Risen Lord, give us joy.
You live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our first lesson this Easter morning comes from Exodus chapter 15. This account takes place right after God has brought the children of Israel through the parted Red Seas and delivered them from the armies of Pharaoh. This is an Easter reading because we are reminded of how our God has come through for us. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. Both horse and driver he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My Father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he has hurled into the sea. The best of Pharaoh's officers are drowned in the Red Sea. The deep waters have covered them. They sank to the depths like a stone. Your right hand, Lord, was majestic in power. Your right hand, Lord, shattered the enemy. In the greatest of your majesty, you threw down those who opposed you. You unleashed your burning anger. It consumed them like stubble. By the blast of your nostrils, the waters piled up. The surging waters stood up like a wall. The deep waters congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy boasted, I will pursue, I will overtake them. I will divide the spoils, I will gorge myself on them. I will draw my sword and my hand will destroy them. But you blew with your breath, and the sea covered them. They sank like lead in the mighty waters. Who among the gods is like you, Lord? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders? This is the word of the Lord. Our second lesson comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that famous resurrection chapter in the New Testament. Here, as Pastor Goetzinger mentioned earlier this morning, we're going to have that famous creedal statement of Paul when he says, "What I received, I passed on to you." This shows that there is a creedal statement that's about to be recited that existed before Paul even wrote this. So we're talking maybe even a few years after the resurrection, we already had creedal statements being passed around about Jesus' resurrection. Hear it from Paul's own lips. "Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believed." This is the word of the Lord. Out of love and respect for the words and works of our Savior, please stand. Our gospel this morning comes from Luke chapter 24. As you know, there are four accounts of the resurrection. This is the Apostle Luke's account. "On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, 'Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again.' Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened." This is the gospel of the Lord.
of the tribe of Judah, the root of David. He has triumphed. Christ is risen.
He is risen.
Now you may take a seat. Rhoda Thomas, are you here today? Rhoda Thomas, I was at her house for a couple hours yesterday. It's a practice in the South Sudanese community that when a member of the family dies, the community gathers together, and it's usually a 5 to 7 hour ordeal. I shouldn't say ordeal, event. Yesterday I was there for a couple of hours. I finally had to get back here and get something cobbled together for you for a sermon message. It's kind of expected on Easter that the pastor should get up and actually say something. Rhoda's uncle died in Khartoum on the 15th. Medical complications. They just don't have the medical system that we have. And she hadn't seen him for a while. And when I finally saw her in the kitchen yesterday, she's really taken it hard. So if you see her today, give her a hug. Maybe she just stayed home. But today is for events like that. Because you see, Easter is a festival that only God could invent. Easter and its message was forged in the heart of God in heaven itself for fragile humanity like us. It was for people who have stolen or lied, committed adultery, for people who drink too much, people who are hooked on pornography. It's for people who have hated in their heart God's other people. It is for people who can't do it all, who don't have it all, and quite honestly, can't make it all okay. It's for people who have clinical depression. It's for people who have stress and pressure in their lives. In fact, in a word, the message of Easter is for people who die. Do you know anyone like that? The titanic efforts of human beings, of humanity, to solve those problems, and many, many more, it's a futile attempt. They will never solve them. But God himself tells us on this day and through this day, God takes all of those gargantuan problems that human beings have and he buries them in a previously occupied tomb. He slams the stone door up against it and he saps all of their power that they have over us from now forevermore because of Jesus. Today is God's doing. Today, God's holiness intersects with us in a very close and personal way. And he says to us this morning through the Apostle Paul to young Timothy, remember Jesus Christ. He has risen. Our sermon message this morning is going to be based on one verse from the Apostle Paul's letter. These are some of the last words he ever wrote before he was martyred for his Savior. When he was beheaded in Rome, he wrote to young Pastor Timothy, remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel. Contrary to what most of religion-dom believes, Christianity is first and foremost about remembering. God's message to us, his main message to us from the beginning of the Bible all through it to the very end, is not go and do, but rather it is see and believe. And that's what we're doing here this morning, here on Easter morning. The great things that our Lord has done for us, we are celebrating, so that also then the forgiveness of sins and eternal life can personally become ours by God's abundant overflowing grace through faith and transform us and give us hope and a purpose in this life and for the life beyond. So remember this morning. Remember the great and glorious things that God has done for us. But you know what? We really can't do anything else, can we? I mean, all we can do is really go to the tomb in our minds, gaze in, see that it's empty, and then kind of recall these facts for ourselves. Ponder the amazing things that have happened these last 3 days that we have celebrated that happened 1986 years ago. You ponder these amazing things that have happened for us. There's nothing that we can do but just remember. There's nothing that we can do, and there's absolutely nothing that we need to do. Because God, in his infinite mercy and grace, has already done it all. All of it. He's taken sin and he's crumpled it up like a piece of paper and he's thrown it in his divine trash basket. And that doesn't mean that we don't still sin. What it means is that the punishment for that sin has been taken away from us because of Jesus. He's taken death and he's absolutely put it to death. And then he's taken hell and he actually marched down into hell itself. And he preached victory to those who were sentenced there then for eternity, who refused to believe the message that God has forgiveness in his heart for people through his Son. We have victory, and he has given us this victory. And it is guaranteed by the resurrection of Christ from the dead, which we just got done looking at in the Bible study previously this morning. It guaranteed this day, guarantees that my sin has been paid for, that the punishment for my sin has been taken away, and as a result, I will be raised back to life when my body is dead and Jesus comes back for all of those, not just me, for all of those who trust that Jesus has done this. It is he, the Apostle Paul says in his first letter to the Corinthians, it is he who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So let me ask you, how in all the world could we possibly forget these great things? Well, Jesus has not changed one whit or one iota in the centuries that he has existed. In fact, the eternity that he has existed. But it's also true that his disciples have not changed a whole lot either. We have fears. We have doubts. We are slow to believe. That's one answer. Some of you may say, well, you know, Pastor, life happens. Yeah, but I'm not going to let you off the hook that easily, because who sets your priorities for you? Then you're the one who makes life happen. Yeah? Remember Jesus Christ. All the more reason that we should heed the encouragement of the Apostle, of the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, in our words before us this morning. St. Paul gives us this reminder, remember Jesus Christ. Now, there's an awful lot of appropriation of the great truths of the Bible in this short little message here this morning, but I'm just going to take a little ad lib. How can you remember Jesus Christ? You read his word, because you cannot remember what you do not know or what you have forgotten. Read his scripture. And I'm not going to pick on you. I'm just going to make an observation. If the last time you were here in worship, and we're glad you're here, please come back next Sunday, but if the last time you were in worship was Christmas, probably be a good thing to think about setting some new priorities, spending some time with Jesus here in worship. I did a quick fact check last night, and according to the Barna poll, 75% of all Americans profess to be Christian as of 2015. 67.5% of all Canadians profess to be Christian as of 2011. What percentage of Christians do you think read their Bible every single day? Shout out some numbers. 3%? Ooh, that's very pessimistic. I thought you'd say like 30%. 50%, that'll show me for asking you to shout out numbers from the gallery, from the church. No, only 10% of all Christians actually break open their Bible, will locate it first of all, and throw the dust off it and break it open and actually read it. 10% of Christians. Let's make it a goal for ourselves. Let's make it 100% of the Christians that are members of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of St. Paul. Spend time with your Savior every day. God himself gave the name Jesus to his son. Jesus, that name, it means Savior. And Jesus came to earth in the quietness of Christmas in order to enter into a very violent battle. He came to do battle with the forces of hell. He came to undo what sin and Satan had done. He came to heal the sick and the lame. He came to drive out demons. He came to raise the dead. But it was on Good Friday that we celebrated just 3 days where it comes to a climax. That's where the finale, the final decisive moment was. God the Son, writhing in agony, remember that. Remember the agonizing Son hanging on the cross. And God and Satan are going head to head and toe to toe for the possession of your eternal soul. There is nothing less on the line than the salvation of God's people and the carrying out of his plan. This was a struggle to the death. This was not a show. And by the end of the day, Jesus, the Son of God, lay dead in a tomb. It was, as Luther wrote in one of his hymns, a strange and dreadful strife when life and death contended. There are only two outcomes when someone predicts their defeat over death. One, they are a fraud, or two, they are a victor. But the hymn goes on to tip the scales and give you an idea how this turned out. The victory remained with life. The reign of death was ended. Jesus has risen. It is historical proof. Jesus is alive. It is historically accurate and provable. And he can also, as a result, say, death has been put to death. Amen. But about death, real quickly. You know it's coming, don't you? You know that it's coming to your friends, to your spouse, to your relatives. It's coming to you. And it's said that we fear most what is unknown. The thing is that death for us is very well known. So why is it that we have such great fear of it? Why? Well, the fear of death comes from, whether you admit it or not, the knowledge that you have of sin. Whether you learned that knowledge of sin from the Bible, from a Sunday school teacher, your mom or dad, your pastor, or whether you learned it from your conscience. You see, deep down in each and every single one of us, there is this understanding that there really is a God, and that he is holy, and that he is just, and that he is righteous. Deep down, we also know that we have not lived as he wants us to live. Live perfectly as he wants us to live. Live perfectly in holy, sinless love for him, but also for every other human being. And the scripture, God's word, the Bible, rather bluntly points out to us, we die because we have sinned. And you weren't intended to die. And that fills you with fear. We were created to live in harmony with God forever and ever and ever. Humans were not intended by design by God to die. But yet, because we have sinned, God gives us this verdict, guilty of eternal death. So what in the world are we supposed to do? Thus the glory of this day. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead. Folks, today is Easter. This is God at his very best, right here. The salvation of souls. The truth of the matter is that there is absolutely nothing blacker than a pit. There is absolutely nothing more lifeless than a grave. And there is absolutely nothing more permanent than a tomb, right? And yet, Jesus allowed himself to be put into that tomb. The maker of humanity willingly gave up his life to put himself into a totally alien environment for the divine maker of all things, to put himself into that tomb for 3 days. And today, we remember what happened at the end of those 3 days. He rose. He came back to life. The heart that had stopped beating, it was beating again. The lungs that had stopped sucking air, the body that hung lifeless on the cross, it was back breathing and moving and being alive once again. You have been raised with Christ, the Bible cheers and shouts and screams and hollers. In Jesus' hour of victory, you were there. And this is how you know. You died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. The Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, shed lamb blood. And it sloshed like a giant, beautiful, red tsunami wave all the way back to the beginning of time, all the way back to Adam and Eve. And then it sloshed and blazed its way to the future, to us. It has washed clean, free from sin, forgiven every sinful fool who has ever lived on this planet. And that includes you. God has forgiven you your sins in the name of his Son. 3 days ago, we and the rest of Christendom knelt before, we knelt before the divine cross, the divine sign of love to humanity. Today, you and I are going to arise from this place, and we are going to go forth, leaving fear and permanent fear behind. Because with God on your side, you have absolutely nothing to fear. We have come to sing our praises of God today for the great things that our Savior has done for us. He has put death to death. So please, if you remember nothing else from my rah, 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 rah up here, remember Jesus Christ. He has risen. He has risen indeed. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, it will guard and keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. While you are standing, if you would please locate your service folder, turn to page 9, and we will join together in confessing our Christian faith using another creedal statement, an ancient creedal statement of the church, the Nicene. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate.
He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. We'll join together now in singing our next hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Alleluia.
I invite you at this time now to turn to page 10 to our prayer of the church. In our prayer this morning, not only will we be praying for Rhoda and her family over the passing of her uncle, Peter Adit, but we will also be praying on behalf of the attacks that took place this last 12 hours or so in Sri Lanka. So there were a number of churches that were attacked by suicide bombers, around 200 or so in Sri Lanka, as well as some hotels as well. So we'll be praying for all those affected by those Easter attacks. Please stand. Heavenly Father, God of grace, you have brought us into a new and living hope by the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. For as in Adam all died, so in Christ all will be made alive. He was delivered over to death for our sins and raised to life for our justification. We marvel at the love you showed by your willingness to sacrifice your Son to pay for our sins. We bow down in adoration at your mighty power, which raised him from the dead. Dear Savior, we who are weary and burdened come to you for rest, knowing that because of your perfect redemption, there is now no condemnation for us. Holy Spirit, God of grace, you have called us by the gospel and brought us to saving faith in our risen Lord. Keep us with Jesus Christ in the one true faith, and as we journey through life, make us yearn for the day when you will give eternal life to us and all believers in Christ. And O Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for all the mercies with which you blessed Peter Adit, now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought him to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would comfort his family, especially Rhoda, our sister in the faith, and all who mourn his death with your precious promises, and cheer them with the sure hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. Grant the lifeless body rest, and at last, together with us all, a joyful resurrection to life everlasting, guaranteed to us by you through your resurrection. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain hearts of wisdom, and finally be saved through Jesus Christ, our risen and ever-living Lord. And Lord Jesus, you are the Prince of Peace. Your Son commanded us to love all, even our enemies, and to pray for them. We pray on behalf of all those that were affected in Sri Lanka in this past day. We pray that you especially protect Christians everywhere that are celebrating your resurrection. Deliver us from prejudice, hatred, and cruelty. Help us endure unjust treatment without seeking revenge. But in these times of trial, fill our hearts with the forgiving love that we learn only from Christ. And may that love so move the hearts of our enemies that one day they and we may stand before you reconciled to you and to one another through your risen Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Work through us as we proclaim the saving message of the crucified and risen Jesus near and far, so that many others may hear your call, obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus, and join us before the throne of our God and of the Lamb. Let God lead us to wait with all his saints in hopeful expectation for the consummation of all things, granting us a confident trust in his promised return. Let us pray to the Lord. Remembering the sufferings and death of your beloved Son, we place our petitions at your throne of mercy, trusting your promise to hear our prayers and grant us all that we need for this life and the life to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, and serve our great God with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. And we'll remain standing for our final hymn.
Thank you.
You may be seated for just a moment. Good morning again. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Welcome to all of our visitors who are with us today. Please take the opportunity to introduce yourself on your way out to Pastor Thompson and me. We'd love to at least shake your hand and give you a smile and a welcome to St. Paul. Just one announcement. Thank you to the Walther League and to the Palazzi clan for our breakfast this morning. Thank you to all who are involved in the Altar Guild work, beautifying our church. And on behalf of Pastor Thompson's family and mine and Sue McDougall, we pray for a most blessed Easter for you today with your family or without. We pray that it gets even better after you depart here, as if it could get any better than this. Safe home and have a blessed journey wherever you're going. We'll greet you in the back.